So now that we're back after being fully, hopefully we won't be too fully fed, we won't be too inebriated by our food to, if you just get sleepy, I'll just call on you. There's no problem there. I'm very attentive most of the time. There was a funny story though about one of our seminary professors who will remain nameless, who just happens to be a very famous bishop now, the Metropolitan, the OCA. And he fell asleep while he was giving his lecture, you know? But he kept going though, that's the amazing thing. he just kept going, but he was sleeping. But it does happen though, because Bishop Metropolitan Callistos Ware also says the same thing. He says that he was asleep and he heard this voice and it just kept droning and droning and droning, and he was thinking, why doesn't that person stop? You know, because he was trying to sleep, and then he realized that he was the one who was droning. He was in the middle of one of his lectures. So it does happen, but that's not one of my gifts. I remember one of the fathers at the monastery, who was a Soviet Russian, he said that there was three kind of distinct stages in his spiritual life. The first was when he came to believe that there was a God. That was the first stage. God exists. Second stage for him was the time when he came to believe, realize, understand, and embrace the fact that Jesus Christ is God. And the third and final stage that he went through in this process of growth in spiritual life was really realizing that the Orthodox Church was the body of Christ. So this was like the three steps that he went through as he was kind of coming out of the post-Soviet era, and kind of his progression, the natural progression of like kind of revelatory experience that he had in his life. That God was, and that Jesus Christ was God, and that the church is his body, and that church is the Orthodox Church. Recently I was just in Russia, and amazing things are going on there. They have 888 monasteries. 888. And the patriarch was laughing. He said, I'm glad we don't have 666. So that was kind of funny. But he invited all of the major abbots and abbesses from all over the world to a conference in Russia that was just held. It was at Christ the Savior Cathedral and Trinity St. Sergius Lavra. I was at the Lavra, the Trinity St. Sergius Lavra, for it was a 2 or 3 day thing, and one of the days could be spent at the Lavra, and I was there with St. Sergius for a couple hours, and it's like the nuclear power plant of the Russian Orthodox Church. It's just the energy and the power and the life are so real and so vital and so transformative. It's just like, whoa, whoa, whoa. The whole church is just like kind of vibrating with this power that's just unspeakable, kind of life, and just, it's like, it just blows your mind, you know? I was so appreciative to be there. And just even in Russia, I realized when I was praying in the morning, I could just feel like, this is like so many millions of people have been Orthodox here for so many hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. And there's so many major, major, major saints just within like a couple miles of where I was. There was like, you know, St. Alexis of Moscow was over here, and St. Matrona was down the street, and St. Tikhon of Moscow was over there. It's just like, it was just so profoundly real, that sense of like being in a holy place or in a holy land or holy Russia. It was real. And it was really the presence of all of that grace and all of those saints who made it so tangible, you know? All those people that struggled and lived their Christian life, it's like Father Sofroni says, it's impossible to live a Christian life, it's only possible to die daily. The calling is from above. It's a reminder of another life, of another way of existence that on some kind of day-to-day level doesn't always compute, because it's so high, the bar is so high, And so what do? We do what we can. And we leave the rest to God. That's the patristic adage. You know, if you do what you can, it's a lot. You know? It's a lot. And I'll never forget, like, I was talking with Gary yesterday. It was like I was reading the gospel the other day, and I'm so deeply impressed by that woman who anointed the feet of Christ. And then Christ says to the disciples, you know, it's interesting that in the one gospel it says Judas said, he looked at the woman and he said, "Why this waste? Why this waste?" You know? And we should never, ever, ever, ever say that about the church or about the adorning of the church or about the chalice or about the nice vestments or about the icons. We should never look at that as something that is like the poorest countries have the nicest churches. You know? Because they have a different perspective on life and their culture and their community, that those things are held in trust, like in common. And it's like their greatest thing is, especially when you're not very wealthy, is to have this beautiful church and to know it's yours. To know it's yours. You know, and I remember in the 90s seeing this article after the wall fell down, and there was this Protestant missionary in I think it was Bulgaria. And on the caption of the photo, there's this person in the church, in this Orthodox church, and they're pointing at everything and saying, that the caption says, "It's terrible. Why this waste?" I said, "I know who said that." You know, to fail to see kind of the church really as the body of Christ and truly as what it is, it's only to our own detriment, you know? It's only to our own detriment. It would be, it's our joy and our privilege to be able to serve in the church, to be able to clean the church, to honor the church, to give to the church. I mean, I'm gonna come and I'm gonna go, but you know, the more you can put into this church and give to this church, the more you're going to benefit yourself. It's innately selfish on some weird level, but the reality is that whatever I give to the church, I'm gonna keep it. Whatever I don't give and I keep, I'm gonna lose, right? Doesn't Christ say that in the Gospels? Whoever saves his life, what? Loses it. Whoever loses his life, what?
Gains it.
So it's the same thing with whatever I give, that's what I'm gonna take with me. Whatever I keep, that's what I lose. So if you wanna lose $1 million, keep it. If you wanna keep it for eternity, build yourself a nice little house in heaven. Doesn't always have to be necessarily to the church, but there's infinite ways to offer that aid, to whether it's in the midst of the church, missionary communities, monasteries, seminaries, the poor, Focus North America. They're doing a great job in Pittsburgh. Just incredible work. Like, you know, you give like, I don't know, it's like you can give towards so many sleeping bags or so many meals. You know, it's like $1,000 buys, you know, this many meals for this many people for this many days at their center, you know, at their shelter. So doing great work, you know, the great outreach that they're doing. And so there's lots of ways to do it. And I would just encourage you to kind of always think outside of the box in that regard. And don't be afraid to kind of give the best to God, you know, the best of your time, the best of your heart, the best of your resources. If God has your heart, He's got your wallet, He's got the rest of it. It doesn't really matter, because if you give Him your heart, that's the most important thing. And this is something that we don't do once, it's something that we continue to do again and again and again. Day after day, year after year, offering our life, our heart, and our whole being to God Himself. And really, this is the task for all of us.
I have the microphone so low, I'm sorry.
Is to learn how to serve on the altar of our heart. Learning how to serve liturgy here. So that when we come here, it is so rich, and it is so real, and it is so vital, and it is so transformative. Why? Because I already know how to serve liturgy. I've already offered up my life on the altar of my heart. I'm a living sacrifice, like St. Paul says. This is your reasonable worship, your reasonable service, your reasonable offering. Sometimes it's very hard, I know. But the reality is that this is what God wants. He says, "Son, give me thine heart," says in the Proverbs, right? This is the task for all of us, how to give our heart to God in a way that's real and that ultimately saves it forever. You know, if I give my heart, I keep it. If I hold on to it, I lose it. Interestingly, you know, that's, all of that stuff with the 40-day prayers and stuff like that, you know what the last thing to decompose is? It's the heart. The heart is the last thing to go, and it's on the 40th day that it finally is gone. Like that it finally decomposes, and that's the 40th day is when God places the soul, once it dies, he places it in the foretaste of eternal torment or eternal life, depending on its state and its life that it's led. So on the 40th day, we have those special prayers for those who have departed this life, because it's on that day that not only their heart is finally decomposed, but also too, that the soul is placed in that place where it will be until the second coming. And that's why if you have somebody that has passed from this life, it's so important to offer the services, the liturgy, and even works of charity on their behalf, you know? I'll never forget that there's one book that they publish. It's a little pamphlet. St. John Maximovich is on the front of the cover, and he's doing a funeral, and there's a widow behind him weeping. And on the front of the book, it says, "The dead urgently need our help." You know, we should never take it for granted that either somebody's saved or that they're not saved. We don't know. Like, that's the height of presumption to presume, you know? It really is a you know, that's God's prerogative, not mine. So it's really important to do what we can for those who repose, and remembering them in prayer is exceptionally important. And if you have a choice, like in your will, leave money to someplace that will. You know? I can't tell you how powerful those prayers are. This thing's got wheels. Oh my gosh. Better move over here, kind of closer to the carpet, in case something happens. It's really important, you know. I'll never forget the time that this woman, she passed away. I was talking about it with Gary yesterday. This woman, she died, and she left her house to the monastery. And we hadn't done any renovations. It was right when I took over as abbot, and. We hadn't done any renovations, our buildings were just totally falling apart. And so I actually built a new house. And I just did it kind of on faith. You know, I asked the Metropolitan, I said, can I have a blessing to, you know, we need more room, you know? And we hadn't built anything up there in the monastery since there was a renovation, there was an addition in the late 80s, but basically no real new building has been built since 61 when we put up the building, the main monastery building that's there now. And I'll just never forget that stepping out in faith and just believing that somehow with Metropolitan's blessing and that with prayer that somehow God would provide, because that's really what we needed. And I'll never forget the day that we broke ground. It was like, I never cried so hard in my entire life. Because somebody sent a check. Like, I needed to put a down payment down to actually start the process, right? You know, when you do that, the company they want, it was like $35,000 or $40,000 that I needed to come up with. And lo and behold, one of our benefactors, Paul, who's since reposed, blessed memory, that like a couple weeks before, he sent $31,000 in the mail. And Paul and Mary, they lived in like the most kind of frugal circumstances I've ever seen in my entire life. You know, Paul would send somebody back to the store because the can of beans was too expensive. You know, he sent back one of the fellows that would take care of him in his last days. Paul said, "You didn't get this on sale. I clipped a coupon. What? Why didn't you get this on sale?" And he says, "Well, I'm sorry. I forgot the coupon, or you know, I got this other one." He's like, "Send it back. Go back and get the 40 cents." And you know, I mean, Paul gave me a blanket. Two or three blankets from 1960 that were still in the bag when I visited one time. Very gladly and very happily. And he thought, like, you know, and but they smelled, oh my gosh. You have really smelled. I mean, they're 50 years old, you know. Still in the bag. And Paul and Mary, God bless them, I'll never forget them. But so that day, or a couple days before, I got the check in the mail. Paul sent the 31. So I had the money for the down payment. So I went and I paid the money, and they came out. And when they broke ground, I cried so hard because it was like knowing that somebody cared about the church that much. It broke my heart. It broke my heart that there are people in this world, like, those kind of people aren't around anymore. We're losing them at the monastery. Like, they're not the norm. They're not the norm. The ones that basically live so simply so that the church can basically have to do what it needs to do, you know, because he sent money to the seminary as well, and basically they live hand to mouth, you know. But the seminary is some of the most important work. Why? Because it's going to replace the priests, you know. Like, a lot of priests are retiring or will retire, and it's like they don't just kind of fall out of the sky, you know. And if they did, I don't know if you'd want them. You know, it's a long process. It's a difficult process. It's you know, it costs money, and ultimately investing in that, you know, like Paul, like, I just, like, the monastery, we didn't have much for a long time, you know. It was like we lived in very humble circumstances, to say the least. And to know that there are people like Paul that would give everything that they had, like the widow, you know, but it was substantial, you know, in the sense of, like, they lived very simply so that other people could you know, do the work that they needed to do. When they broke ground, it was like I felt like the ground itself, like, cried out, like, thank you, God. Because we were doing this work to build another building which had not been, nothing had been done up there for 50 years. Not even some of the carpet had been original, you know, from 61. It's this terrible green stuff, you wouldn't believe it. Also a pink color that was very scary. But nevertheless, we started the project, and then I was kind of worried because, so they set the house, because I got a modular home for that first house. Very nice, you know, they can build it inside, which means they can work in the wintertime and stuff, and they're just the same quality if you get a good company, you know. It's just a house, and they set it, and then they build the roof and everything like that. But I didn't have the money, and I owed $100,000. So I'm praying, and I need to pay cash. I'm paying cash for this house, right? I don't take out loans. I don't do that, I'm sorry. Not that kind of monk. And so we were praying, and finally I got the word that Irene, her house had sold, and that the money was in, and then I had to go to Sanford in Connecticut. And I'll never forget the day that I came back and I was able to get the check that was for $100,000. And I took it right to the bank the next day. I put it under my pillow that night because I never had a check for $100,000. I put it underneath my pillow because I didn't know what to do with it. And I took it to the bank, and then within a couple of days I paid the contractor and paid him off. And it was when I paid the contractor, I knew that we had a house and Irene did too. I knew it. I just, in deep inside, like, I knew, beyond a shadow of a doubt, because it was, Irene had passed away about a year before. I just knew she's got a house and it's nice. It's nice because she remembered the Lord, and therefore the Lord will remember Irene. Interesting, you know, the rich man in the gospel, the parable of Lazarus and the rich man. You know that parable in John, or in Luke chapter 17 or whatever, where Lazarus is always begging at the gate of the rich man, and the rich man always walks by and said, get out of my way. And he says, and the rich man, he fared sumptuously and had nice clothes and blah, blah, blah. And the poor man, he was just always outside just wanting a crumb that would fall from the rich man's table. And then, of course, the rich man goes down to the bad place, and Lazarus goes to the good place. And even in hell, the rich man saying, Abraham, can you get this guy to come over here and serve me? Like, he's, you know, again, failing to recognize Lazarus as a person at all, right? And really, that's so important to be able to look at each other and see person, not problem, not principle, not philosophical, whatever, but person, right? This is imperative for us because in that account, the rich man, we don't know his name because his memory is not eternal. He didn't become a person. Personhood is only actualized And if that process just doesn't come to fruition, or if it doesn't happen at all, what am I really? If I'm without God, I'm without myself, and so I have no name in an eternal sense. And that's scary. God forgot the rich man's name and remembered Lazarus' name, and it's in the gospel forever. So I think that it would be good just to kind of mention, Father Sinfoni has three stages of spiritual life that are really good to know about, because they help us as we continue on our journey of spiritual existence. And they have the three stages of spiritual life, purification, illumination, deification. It's like, that doesn't really kind of make sense on some kind of practical day-to-day level. By the way, you know what the word for purification is in Greek, right? Catharsis. Has anybody ever had a catharsis? Isn't that fun? It's not fun, is it? It seems like a bad thing. When people are having a breakdown, that's a catharsis. And guess what? That's what purification is. Isn't that great? It's really kind of coming to wit's end, getting to the end of ourselves so that God can begin his work. It's the point where we come to an end so that God can make a beginning. And we don't like to go there as a human being and as people in general, but the reality is that if we follow Christ, like I said this morning, it will be a journey down. Just like Job, right? Job lost everything. He was a righteous man. He was following God. And he went through some very difficult times. Why? So that as gold is tried in the furnace of temptation, so acceptable men are tried in the furnace of humiliation, so that they begin to shine, as the prophet Sirach says in the apocryphal book, The Wisdom of Sirach. It's important for us to be able to patiently, prayerfully go through those difficulties so that ultimately through that cross we find the resurrection. Because without the cross, there is no resurrection. Without that difficulty, affliction, pain, and suffering, there will be no opportunity for the shining, to manifest the virtue, and to kind of become those champions, strong and mighty for God, that we all need to become. It's in adversity that virtue is truly tested and begins to manifest itself. It's not the good times that will always help us to be who we need to be, but rather it's in those moments of testing that we really find out who we are and ultimately can find God as well. So in this light, the three stages of the spiritual life is the first one is called the first grace, right? Everything's so nice, everything's so lovely, I can pray very easily, everything, I have the grace goggles on, that's what I call them. People come to the monastery and they get a free pair of grace goggles. Because that is the reality there, but it's time expiration, it's only for a little while. As Father Sinfoni says, this is unrighteous mammon, it's not really ours. We taste it so that we can understand what it is. And some people actually receive during their first grace, whether it's right when they become Orthodox, or right when they come back to Christianity, or right when they go to the monastery, or whatever it is, but they come back to the church, they get a first grace. It's like this opportunity to taste of perfection without the work that's entailed. And it's important to realize that this is temporary. This is temporary. We'll all get, everybody in this room, because you're here, number one, it's a miracle that we're here. Okay, it really is. In order to be a Christian, you can't do that unless it's by the Holy Spirit. So in some sense, we're responding to God. In some sense, in order to be able to be here today and to become an Orthodox Christian, it's like this is a God's call and our response, and it's a miracle. It's kind of miraculous that we're here and that we're called Orthodox Christians. It's no small thing to be able to be a Christian, let alone an Orthodox Christian. That's what the saints say. They say it's no small thing to be called a Christian, because ultimately it means that God has been working and I've been responding. So this first grace is, it might happen a couple of times depending on how your life goes, you know, depending on, you know, what, like I remember when I became a Christian, it was like this, and then when I went to the monastery, it was like this. So there's a first grace. It doesn't last. Don't worry. That's the norm. This period can be anywhere from 2 hours to 7 years. Maybe even 10 minutes, depending on how it's going. The second period. And this is really, by the way, the first grace is like, Israel, coming out of Egypt. Right? Same thing. They saw the lights, they saw the ocean parting, they got manna for free. Everything was just like, wow. Okay? They came out of Egypt, the grace was substantial. Then, oh boy, what happened after that for the Israelites? Wandering where?
In the desert.
The desert. So this is the desert period. The desert period. Can you spell desert? Desert? That's desert, right?
Yeah.
I guess desert is two S's, right?
Yes.
Right.
Two deserts.
Yeah.
Yes, two deserts, one dessert. So, and this is a period of testing. And guess how long this period lasts for? Years and years and years. 40 years in the desert, right? 40 years is that number of like kind of completion, right? The Lord fasted for 40 days. Israelites were in the desert for 40 days. 40 is a symbolic biblical number, but it means a time of fullness, a time of completion, a long time. Most of us are in this second period right now. Welcome to the desert. Can I take your order? And we are fed with manna, thank God, right? The church, we get the Eucharist. And there's also lots of other ways that we can maintain our inspiration in the desert. And that's really like the question for all of us. How do we attain the grace of God and retain the grace of God and make this kind of our priority? Because we can lose the grace of God. It's not like something that I just get, and I'm like, oh yeah, I deserve it. It's like, no. It's something that I receive, and that if I'm not careful with, I can drop, and it can break, and it can, you know, it could all drain out on the floor before I even get to the parking lot. You know, if I go to the coffee hour after I receive communion, I start seeing about how bad this person is, and about how I don't like that, and why is this, and why is that, and I'm the right one, and, you know, grace of God's like, bye. I'm going to stay in the church. I'm not going with you. You know, and so we have to be careful because we can lose the grace of God. And only those who have lost it know how sad that is, you know. And it can be pretty catastrophic as well, you know. It's not like we're just talking about kind of mild grace. The reason why the church tells us not to sin is because it makes us become so hardened sometimes that we're like, what am I doing in this church anyways? I don't want to be here. Like, let's say we had some kind of terrible fall or something. I don't know, think of all the bad stuff, right? Any of those number of the bad things. That hardens us so much that sometimes the grace of God can't abide in us anymore. And we're like, what am I doing here? Why am I a Christian? What's that? I don't believe in Jesus anymore. Just, this is all, you know, weird stuff. I don't know. What was I doing? What was I thinking? We can get like that. And so that's why we have to be careful. It's not just going to, by the way, it really, you know, sin is the deconstruction of our soul. It really does pick apart the fabric of our being on a very deep and ontological level so that we destroy ourselves. And I'm the first person that does that. And, you know, Lord have mercy. Like, isn't that crazy? That's what the fall is, though. St. Paul says, woe to me, I do what I don't want to do, and I don't do what I want to do. You know, it's this old man, new man, who are constantly kind of fighting and bickering inside of us, and ultimately, there was a saying, is who's going to win? It says, the one that you feed. Do you feed the old man, or do you feed the new man? The more I feed the old man, the bigger he gets, and I kind of forget about the new man. It's like, well, where did he go? Or woman, man or woman, whatever. But if I feed the new man, if I give life and energy and attention and put my energy into that, the old man just kind of shrivels up, you know? He's not really much of a thing to deal with on some level sometimes. So, we're in the desert, the period of testing. Paul suggests that there's three main ways that we, I'm out of your viewfinder. There's three main ways that we can retain or obtain the grace of God in this desert period. So the three easiest ways are the Jesus prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. It's a dialogue, it's not a mantra. And ultimately, it's an easy way to maintain myself in God's presence. And ultimately, receive the impartation of the energy of that name. That name is light. That name is grace. It has a divine energy that is just like any word. Like every word has an energy, like we're talking about earlier. Stop! Come over here. Oh, I love you. Right? All these words have energy. There's an energy behind them. In the name of Jesus Christ, there's an energy, and it's divine. And ultimately, it gives us strength. And, you know, there's hope, and there's life, and there's light in that name. Second way to achieve and to acquire the grace during the second time of testing is the scriptures. And the more I am open and receptive and prepared as I encounter the scriptures, the more I'm going to receive from them. There's a wellspring of incredible power and incredible inspiration in the scriptures. And a lot of times, if you do read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John over and over and over and over again, and they become the foundation and bedrock of your being, if you do that on a daily basis, that chapter a day like we're talking about, not only will I be really happy, which I know you want, because I'll be in Pennsylvania and I'll know if you're doing it or not, just like Santa, right? But not only that, but it'll be weird. God will actually speak to you, and there'll be the exact word that you need on the exact day. You'll be like, wow. It's like, there it is. It's like God's like, excuse me. You know, kind of like, hello. And it'll be something like that you either need to hear or something that you need to be encouraged by. There's sometimes it's uncanny. Like there was like some days where it was like the reading that I really needed and I didn't want to hear was not only the one that I heard when I was reading my sequential readings, you know, exactly on the day that I needed to see it, which I didn't want to see, but just as a, you know, kind of another punch in the church was the same reading as well on that day. So, you know, how could that happen? Come on. You know what I mean? It's like, but that's what it's like. You know, God can speak to us, especially in the scriptures, because it is his word. And ultimately, Christ says that the words that I speak to you are spirit of life. He says, the world will pass away. He says, but my words will never pass away. They're eternal. When God spoke this world into existence, that same word is in the scriptures. And that's why it's on the gospel, it's on the altar right now. Very center of the Orthodox Church, the very center of the throne of God is God's word. It's the word of God. It's the gospels. It's a very important part of our life. And ultimately, if it becomes more in a part of the fabric of our thinking and about like how I kind of relate to the world and how I think about the world, if it becomes a bigger part along with like, you know, the patristic books and so forth, the commentary on the gospel. If you don't know, if like you're confused by something in the gospel, there's a great commentary by St. Theophylact. It's only like four volumes, one for each gospel. Very easy, very simple, but very good. St. Theophylact, the commentary on Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There's a lot of those resources that help to open up the scriptures even more. And by the way, it's the easy way to kind of enter into the mystery of the mind of Christ, you know, because St. Paul says, you know, the natural man receives not the things of the Spirit, but they are spiritually discerned, but we have the mind of Christ. It's like, that's an incredibly powerful and bold thing to say. And the reality is that the mind of Christ is not in the scriptures per se, because it's bigger than that. It's in the church, of which the scriptures are part of that tapestry and fabric, an integral part, the center part, but nevertheless part of that fabric of the tapestry of the church. The mind of Christ is the mind of the church. And if you want that mind, it's not going to be coming to you by some kind of informational way, where if I just read enough, I'll learn how to think right, and everything will be fine, right? The reality is that it's an impartation of the grace of God that forms my mind and that illumines me and enlightens me in such a revelatory way that it's by the grace of God that my news is basically like St. Paul says, be transfigured by the metamorphosis of your news. Be renewed by the metamorphosis of your news, the transfiguration of your news. It's literally like the reconstruction of the very deepest part of us. So when I look for the mind of the church, the easiest way that I can do that is in the third one. I just show up the divine liturgy. In the divine liturgy, we are offered the life of God Himself. And I can't say enough about the liturgy. I serve or go to liturgy every single day, except when I'm out here, you know, or out and about. But for the most part, I've logged about 20,000 liturgical hours. It only takes 10,000 to be an expert. So, and I'm definitely not an expert. I can tell you for a fact, because the more I know, the more I know I don't know. You know, it's like the liturgy and the liturgical life of the church, which we have Vespers and Matins every day and do the full cycle. They are profoundly deep. And what they reveal is the mind of the church, which is the mind of Christ. It's not something that's like just in the books per se, or just in the canons, or just in this, or just in that. It's something mysterious. It's something you can't put your finger on necessarily. I can point at it, but it's bigger than that. All I can be is open to it. And hopefully, Father Zechariah says, the liturgy is the school whereby we are initiated into the mystery of eternity. The liturgy is timeless. Kind of outside time. It's in time and it's outside of time. It's like there's this weird kind of convergence of two worlds in the liturgy. And in the most substantial way, Christ is present in the liturgy. He's the celebrant, he's the receiver and the received. He's the one who's offering and being offered. It's a great mystery, and yet there's nothing higher, St. John Cronstadt says, nothing more holy, nor anything more life-giving on this earth than the divine liturgy. It really is the door to the kingdom, the most substantial door that I can point at and offer to you today. And really, it is the greatest gift that God has given to the world. All of this helps me to prepare for this. And then once I receive this, I go back to this. It's a cyclical motion of interior life and exterior, like personal prayer and corporate prayer. It just keeps feeding into each other. So that as I continue to go to church and as I continue to have an inner life, they feed each other. But this is the way, as in the desert, when we're in the desert, these are the three things that we need to hold on to, because they help us to maintain inspiration. They help us to maintain our perspective, our focus. They're the compass. When the night gets dark and things are difficult, this is our hope. This is our help. This is what gives us strength. Sure, there's lots of other things. I'm just giving you a couple because we only got a little bit of time. You know? So if you want to spend a semester with me, just come on out. I'll take you. Third period is the acquisition, the final acquisition of grace. The final acquisition of grace, which is literally a kind of like a bit of perfection, you know, or dispassion, maybe on some level, depending on how proficient you are. But really, if you are faithful in this second time of testing, this is guaranteed. This is guaranteed. At the very end, or somewhere close to the end of your life, you'll receive your reward. If you have gone through these and remained faithful, depending on what you get, then you know it depends on how much you put in the sense of just like the bank. You know, if you put in money in an investment, you get out lots of interest. It's the same thing. The more we put in, the more that we'll receive at the end. And ultimately, it's not a works righteousness thing. You know what I mean? It's like this, all of this time of preparation, it's just, it's ultimately preparing to make room for the gift. Asceticism is not an end in and of itself. It's preparatory. It's a means by which I can attain to the goal. The goal is that gift of grace that God wants to give to us. How much room is inside me? How much space am I making? How enlarged is my heart? This is the enlargement of the heart right here. The more room I have, the more that the final acquisition will be greater. So we're not talking about like works righteousness, you know? I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about doing a bunch of good things so that I can get all my goodies at the end. You know, God is going to fill all things with himself. This is the reality that we face. How much room is there going to be for the guest? Have I acclimatized myself to that life of heaven which the divine liturgy offers me, or have I not? Have I learned how to stand in the presence of God in the divine liturgy and in my time of prayer and in kind of searching for God in the scriptures and those other ways that I might do it? Have I learned how to do that so that in eternity I will be able to do it as well? Because this is the forecourt and the foretaste of all of that. So this is really important to help us so that we don't get discouraged in the second time of testing. Like, what did I do wrong now? Right? That's what we might ask during the second period. Like, is this really the way it's supposed to be? Oh my goodness, you know? One of the fathers said that if anybody knew the gifts of God, just how great they were, everybody would run to try to receive them. He says, but if everybody knew how hard it was, nobody would go to get them. So don't be discouraged. As far as Zacharias, I like one of the scriptures, it's one of my favorites, says, in your patience possess your soul. And even better, in Father Zacharias, it says, in your patience possessing your person. Actualize your personhood through your patience. Very, very important. Very, very important so that we don't get discouraged and that ultimately we can maintain our spiritual life in the midst of some of the greatest difficulties because, you know, this is tough stuff, you know? I mean, who in this room has not had a hard time? Please raise your hand. You know? Who is not struggling right now? Please raise your hand. Who doesn't have a cross? I'd like to give you one. Please raise your hand. You know, the reality is that St. Innocent says that God has given everybody, fashioned everybody a very specific and special cross, unique to each person, that will lead them to salvation. That one thing that you just can't bear about yourself, or that the dark secret, or the hard trial, or the difficult affliction that's been going on for so many years, or whatever it is, that one thing that you kind of, that's the most difficult for you to bear with, guess what? That's a gift. It's a gift from God. Have you ever read that book, This Was From Me? It's this little pamphlet. It's written by St. Seraphim. It's one of the newer St. Seraphims from the late 1900s, late 1800s, early 1900s. And very beautiful. But basically, it kind of goes through this catalog of very difficult events. You know, did this happen to you? And did you have this misfortune? And did this financial crisis be upon you? Well, I want you to know that this was from me. And then it goes on. Did you have this problem? And did this happen to you? And was this, did you get very sick? And were you, you know, were you near death's door? And I want you to know this is a gift from me. And then did this happen to you? And this, you know, like all of this, it's very good. Look it up online because you'll be able to find it. This was from me by St. Seraphim. Very wonderful. Very beautiful. Again, why does God do this? Because he loves us so much. And ultimately, I remember I said, Father Zacharias one time when he was at the monastery, I said, Father, I said, why do we suffer so much? Why is it so hard? And he said, because the gifts of God are so great. It's interesting that it's not easy to stand in God's presence. It's very hard. Remember when the prophet Isaiah saw God, what did he do? He fell down on his face and said, uh-oh. I'm in trouble. I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell amongst the midst of an unclean people. He said, woe is me, for mine eyes have seen the Lord of hosts. And it's no different from any of the other saints. You know, it's like to bear the full presence of God. You remember Indiana Jones in the last layer? What was that? The last, no. Raiders of the Lost Ark. Remember that? Come on. Thank you. Remember what happened when they opened up the ark and everybody melted?
Yeah.
And then Indiana Jones and his friend, they closed their eyes and they were okay because they knew that they couldn't bear it. And the presumptuous Nazis, they thought that they could, yeah, give it to me. I can do anything. You know, I'm strong, I'm great, I'm whatever. You know, it's like, but the Indian and his friend, they knew that that was too much. You know, all those guys melted, remember? And it's actually suffering that enables us to be able to bear the presence of God. It's when we look at the cross, by the way, so I was talking with Gary the other day, that's a cross, right? What also is it? It's a big plus sign. It's a big plus sign, isn't it?
Yeah.
The cross, it's a plus. It's not negative, it's positive. It gives us something. And ultimately, what is this? This is a revelation of God's own life. And what is that life for man? A cross. After the fall, God's life for man computes to this. It's difficult. It's hard. It's not something that's like the ten precious moments Jesus, you know? It's not like that, you know? It's like the Ark of the Covenant, Raiders of the Lost Ark kind of stuff. It's hard. It's not easy to bear the full presence of God. And so God conditions us and enables us through virtue and through the crosses in our own life to learn how to bear this presence, to stand in this presence, to abide in this presence, to live in this presence that is so life-giving and so true, you know? And yet, that's precisely what the church is. It's like in the liturgy, we learn how to stand and live in the presence of God. Sometimes it's like heaven, and sometimes it's like hell. Because the grace, the super celestial grace, St. John Climacus says, is one and the same. It both illumines and burns. Very important, because we can't be those good time Christians only. We have to understand what we're doing here. It's very important for us if we're going to make it, you know? And having this proper understanding of how it works is imperative, because it's serious stuff. And not only that, it's like St. Paul says, it says, our God is a consuming fire, you know? And there's one other quote in Hebrews that he says, what does it say? I'm kind of tired, so I apologize. I'm in a different time zone, but anyways, you get what I'm saying, right? This is a revelation of God's life. It's a cross for man, but ultimately it leads us to a resurrection. It's always imperative to see this as a positive process, though. This is a plus sign, guys. Look, plus. When you look at it and you think about the cross in your own life, those difficult things that you find unbearable, it's a plus sign. It's positive. It can lead you to a better place. The task is how to put it into God's hands, how to leave it in God's hands, how to continue to offer it up moment by moment, day by day, through that dialogue that we talked about. And if I do, my cross becomes my resurrection, and it gives me a rich entrance into eternity. So, let's see, what time do we have till?
3:45.
Oh, we're on till 3:45? Can somebody turn a little bit of air on? I don't want to be like Bishop Callisto soon. Oh, you know, somebody asked me during the break, though, they had a really good question that I think that I just need to comment on just briefly about the...
contemplation versus imagination.
No, that one, we kind of figured that one out during the break, too, but that whole idea of when we're talking about what is the real problem with us? Well, the real problem with us is called death. When we receive our congenital inheritance from Adam is not guilt. Right? Original guilt is the presupposition that from Adam we've all received this thing called ancestral guilt or original sin. Okay? It's a very Augustinian Western concept, and it comes from a faulty interpretation of Romans 5:12 in the Vulgate, which is the Western scripture. What we inherit from Adam is not guilt, but death. And if we understand it correctly, that inheritance, that congenital inheritance of death, being what we receive from Adam, it touches every single level of my being, my heart, my mind, my emotions, my soul. Every part of me has been foiled or tainted or corrupted by this death, so that ultimately I die. Pretty fatal, isn't it? This inheritance. I don't receive the guilt, though. I'm not guilty, except for my own problems, which are plenty. I don't need Adam's, you know? I don't know about you, but I got plenty to worry about without having someone else's guilt on my mind, you know? But that whole issue of having someone else's guilt in original sin, which is kind of the foundation of Western Christendom, it doesn't exist in the Eastern Church. Why? Because we don't have a faulty interpretation or a faulty translation of the Vulgate from the Greek, from 5:12, when St. Jerome translated Romans 5:12. He left out one participle. So it led to it sounding like that in Adam everybody sinned and was guilty. Right? But in the Greek it's very clear. I don't receive the guilt, I receive the death. I receive the death. And so what is the problem with everybody in this room? We're all gonna die. Isn't that bad? And yet that's the one thing that we run from like the plague. I remember one seminarian one time, he said, you know, entertainers are the highest paid people in our society. Why? I thought to myself, huh. Because they help us to forget that we're going to die. They entertain us, they dance, they play their songs, they throw their balls, you know, we're all laughing. And we're forgetting about death. We're forgetting about the fact that we have to meet our maker, and that we have to face the music. We do everything we can to run from that truth in our own heart and in our lives. And so, just like in any self-help or even a 12-step program, they always say, move towards the pain, not away from it. Don't run from this stuff, move towards it. If you move towards it, it gets better. If you keep running, it gets worse. We don't run from the pain, and we don't run from the difficulty of who we are, what we've done, and where we've been. We move towards it and deal with it, and offer it to God. You know, there's a basic pastoral principle that's applicable here. When you're in seminary, there's two things that as a priest you have to learn how to do. One, you get people to name the problem. Sometimes it takes somebody a long time to be able to say what they did or what is wrong. Whatever the problem is, you have to name it. Put your finger on it and say, this is it, right here. It's this chair that the problem, get this one out of here. Just kidding, to see if you're awake. Getting anybody, whether it's ourselves or somebody else, to name the problem is the first step. Because if I can't name it, then how am I going to solve the problem if I can't tell you what it is? So from a pastoral standpoint, that might be a process that takes somebody years. They might have to go to a good Christian therapist. They might have to go through a lot of their own internal struggle and repentance to be able to name the problem. But once you name it, the second part of the equation is to have the person connect that problem and that naming of that problem to God, to offer it to God. And so one of the most transformative and powerful things that you can do in this regard is right here. Everybody knows what this is, right? What is it?
Confession.
Right? If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just. He will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And you know what? Being able to say it, it it basically begins the process of taking it away. The moment that I confess it, it's the beginning of the healing. It's the beginning of the resolution and ultimately of my growth towards God. So if there's something that you haven't ever confessed, do it. If you know you need to confess it, do it. Why? You have nothing to lose. You have everything to gain. We all have lots of problems, you know? We're human beings, we're fallen in this fallen world. This is one of the greatest opportunities that you have to find peace. You know what paradise is? It's right here. My heart, this is the garden, right here. Am I gonna talk to the snakes and do the monologue thing? Or am I gonna listen to the Lord and resume the dialogue? And in the midst of this garden of the heart, the greatest thing that I can have is a peaceful conscience through confession. By being totally right with God in the sense of, this is exactly what is going on in my life. And when I am that transparent, I am free. I am totally free. Devil can't get me. I've refused that false self of the ego, that image that I want to present for Father. It's all fake, you know what I mean? It's like this game that I'm playing with myself of trying to project the ego onto whoever I'm dealing with, especially like somebody that's in a religious position of authority, right? I want to be good for Father, right? But I don't want him to know how bad I really am. If I can go to Father and be completely transparent, I know I'm a goofball, I'm sorry. I know I'm goofy. But you guys are falling asleep, so I gotta keep you in the room. It's 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I've done this for so many years, you know, I know. If I can be totally honest with one other person, especially in the context of confession, that is my ticket to freedom. Whatever it is, name it. It'll be gone. At least the process of healing will begin. The moment I can name it and I can bring it here and confess it, you know, confession is extremely powerful. I can't tell you how powerful it is. You know that some people that are on their deathbed, I've seen it. They go, they have confession. The priest comes to the deathbed. They have confession. They give their life confession of things maybe they never told anybody and they never said because they're at death's door. And they receive communion. And then a day later, they rise up and they go out and they go back to work. Just like the paralytic in the gospel, right? He was paralyzed. And Jesus doesn't say to the man, he doesn't go over to him and said, "You're healed, get up." He doesn't say that. He says, what does he say? "Your sins are forgiven." And then the man gets up. Sin paralyzes us on the deepest level of our being. We may justify it. We may love it. We may think it's us. It's not. It is not. It is the congenital inheritance of death working deeply inside of us and deluding us into believing that that is somehow me. It's not me. It's not me. And this is where I can begin to find that out and to actually like actualize that on a real and transformative level. One of the things that I recommend to people as they're coming back to the church, which is very difficult for some people to do, but extremely powerful and extremely transformative, is to do a life confession. So do a life confession. You start at the beginning and you say what's wrong. You say what went wrong and how it was, being as concise and as brief as possible. You know, you don't want to kind of, it's not an opportunity to kind of write the long version of the story. It's to tell your story in such a way so that you can hear it. And that you can come to terms with it, that you can name those things, and that ultimately you can offer them to God. And then through the mystery of the sacramental presence in the priesthood, you actually are like the paralyzed man. The bandages and the bondages, they open up and the locks are broken and you rise. And you can walk out of there for real, in a real way. It's not like I'm constantly paralyzed by this, that, or the other. It's like, it really does work. And if you've never done that, I would highly recommend it, because, you know, it's easy for me, because I'm going to be leaving. Bye. Bye, Father. But it's extremely real, and it's extremely worth it. I can't offer you anything that's more to make a better beginning than that. Or if there's something that you haven't really talked about or that you need to talk about, do it. What do you have to lose? I think Steve Jobs said something like, you know, remembering that you're going to die reminds us that we have nothing to lose. Because, you know, he just died recently, you know, with the founder of Apple. And but he said that, right? You know, as he was going towards his end, it's like, yeah, that's right. I got nothing to lose, you know? Except maybe the ego in that funny car that we were driving earlier, right? With the exhaust of the monologue. So this is really a great opportunity. And the sacramental, or the real kind of capacity for that, is actually vested in the priesthood. It's in John 21, right? John 20, the end of John 20, end of John 20. Right, when Christ says, receiving the Holy Spirit, whoever sins you forgive, they're forgiven. Whoever sins you retain, they're retained. He wasn't kidding. He gave it to the apostles, and the apostles gave it to the bishops, and the bishops gave it to the priests. That same authority, that same power, from hand to hand to hand to hand, all the way to the hand of Christ. And you know what? No other religion in the entire world promises and even guarantees the forgiveness of sins like we do. Amazing. When you're on your deathbed, what are you going to really want? I want to be forgiven, and I want communion, if possible. Please, God, amen. Right? That's my prayer. Like, I want those two things, right? Because they're priceless. These are the treasures of the church that we have that we need to utilize now before it might be too late. You know, if we have a stroke or something like that, we won't be able to do this. You know, while you're in your right mind and while you have the opportunity, make hay while the sun shines. Utilize these great treasures of the church for your own benefit, for your own salvation. You won't be disappointed. You won't be disappointed. You'll be set free by them. And ultimately, you'll receive that great gift that the Lord himself promised to us, which is salvation. So, I can go on and on and on, and I usually do at seminary, but does anybody have any questions that you're burning, dying to ask, or want to know, or afraid to ask? And I'll answer anyways. Because I do that all the time. You know, I do this for years, and people always come to me at the break when I'm ready to leave. Say, Father, I didn't want to ask this during the session, but, and then they give me the long question.
Next year is the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation beginning. Mm. If somebody were to ask you back in seminary what the Orthodox view of that is, what would you tell them?
Well, the story is actually really interesting about the Protestant Reformation, because Martin Luther actually did not want to create a separate organization. That was not his intention. His intention was originally to reform the Catholic Church. Unfortunately, the Pope, like most popes, was kind of not very sensitive in a pastoral way, and excommunicated him and only exacerbated the situation immensely. We live in a Protestant society now, by and large, that has basically forgotten the ancient church. You know, the whole perspective about the apostolic sees and the work that St. Paul and St. Peter did. I mean, like, if you look at the wonderful, do I even have it here? Maybe I got it. Sometimes they carry this stuff around, sometimes they don't. If you look at the Bishop of Antioch, you know, it goes all the way back to St. Peter. They have a nice list of their 261 bishops from St. Peter. You know, for us, it's just kind of a given. But for the rest of our society, we don't realize it's like, oh, look at this beautiful continuity that we have in the church. The Protestant Reformation, though, really created a chasm whereby, like, all that was forgotten. And the whole paradigm of Christianity was radically altered. So, after Martin Luther passed away, one of his disciples, I forget what his name was, but he went to Patriarch Joachim, I think the third, the Bishop of Patriarch of Constantinople, to try to get recognition. Trying to get some kind of validation, because they realized they were out on a limb. They just realized, we're outside the church right now. We're like kind of hanging on the, you know, on the branch, kind of saying, help. And so he went to Patriarch Joachim, and they really couldn't find a common dialogue, you know, a common ground, because obviously Luther's disciple was from, you know, kind of far off. And, you know, patriarchs in Constantinople, which was taken over by the Turks at that time, it was a very difficult time. So it really wasn't the opportune moment for dialogue. And I don't think really the Protestants were really ready to kind of come into Orthodoxy. They wanted some kind of validation that they were okay, you know, because basically Orthodoxy had rejected those errors that the Protestants were rejecting as well, you know. Some of the abuses and the strange aberrations that happened later in Roman Catholicism, that was part of the divide, you know, between East and West, at least historically, in the Great Schism. So, yeah, a very unique situation at that point. But it's very important to remember that the Protestant Reformation, they did not want to start a new organization. They were looking for reform, not a complete break and complete shattering of an already difficult situation. But I think, though, that it's really difficult for us. We've kind of forgotten where we've come from and how the church has functioned for the past 2,000 years, and so everybody's kind of on their own. The advent of the printing press was also concurrent at this time. You know, you realize all these historical phenomena that are going on. I mean, the Gutenberg, it's Santa. So you realize that the printing press was just, the advent of it was just happening around the same time. So basically the common person could start having the Bible. And not only that, was like, you don't realize that the Bible didn't really exist before the printing press in the classic way that we understand the Bible now, right? In the Orthodox Church, show me where the Gospels are. Well, they're over here. Can you show me where the Epistle is? Well, it's right over there. Where is the Old Testament? Well, it's in the Prophetologion over in there, some of it. Where is the Psalms? It's like, oh, it's on that stand over there. So you have all this pile of books, you know? It's kind of scattered everywhere in the church, which is where, you know, where it comes from. But the phenomenon of a Bible, it's like, what is that? It's a very new concept. So that as you kind of collect all of these writings and put them into one book, this is a phenomenon that had not ever happened before. And it's just on the cusp of the Reformation. And so you have this whole different world kind of coming out of the advent of the printing press that we kind of take for granted nowadays. And it's you know, very interesting. So that basically everybody now can have the Bible, and you never would have the opportunity really to read all of the scriptures outside of the context of the church. It just oftentimes did not happen. It was always in a liturgical context that you would hear Genesis, that you would hear the prophet Isaiah, that you would hear the Gospels. It would always be in that context of worship, you know, part of the tapestry of the fabric of the church. It would be an integral part of that worshiping tapestry, you know. So, what was your question?
what the Orthodox view of how we look at the beginning of the Protestant world?
Well, it's obviously a reaction to the abuses of Catholicism, and it's rightly so on some level. But the question is that they really didn't want to create a whole new kind of world, which is what happened, and just the fragmentation that happened at the schism only continued to fragment even more and more and more and more. And so this is continually breaking and fragmenting of these last remains of these vestiges of the church. It's very sad, you know, very sad.
Uh-huh. I have a question. I want to get back to this idea of, I hear one of the underlying themes that you've been talking about is communion and the importance that we don't exist as soul entities, that mm-hmm. you know, God wants us to form that relationship with Him and with each other. And mm-hmm. and I go back to you were going back to Genesis, and you were talking about after Genesis 1 where God says, you know, it was very good when He looks at man. But then at the beginning of Genesis 2, God says it is not good for man to be alone. And in my Protestant background, I was under this idea that he was saying that Adam was lonely, and I don't think that's what it means now from an Orthodox idea.
Well, it means community.
He wants Adam to participate in the process of creation, co-creating.
Well, he needs community.
Exactly.
Whatever context that is, whether it's church or otherwise, it's like he needs somebody else to basically so he can see himself.
So after he sins, it says he heard footsteps, meaning that he was already communing with God in a sense, perhaps with the...
Well, he was created in communion. It was the innate, yeah, natural state of man to be in communion, and that's like a big problem with us now as we look back. We don't come from monkey land. We come from a place where, you know, we were in communion with God. That's the natural state of man, is to be in communion with God, according to the Orthodox anthropology. And dispassionate, and without sin, and holy.
So in the Western sense of Adam being created in innocence, mm-hmm, does the Orthodoxy have that same sense?
It would be more simplicity or childlike, yeah, childlikeness. You know, Adam just wasn't experienced. I mean, he was a babe as regards to knowledge. So he's just like, uh-oh, what did I do? God's like, out. He's like, huh? Like, bye.
So Adam was...
not very short dialogue.
So in a sense, Adam was in that first stage you were talking about, the first stage of everything being great and...
In a way, yeah. In a way he was, yeah. But the important thing to remember about again, like I was saying, is that man was created by God in a unique way, right? I personally, sorry, I don't believe in evolution. I don't believe there's enough evidence for it. I believe there's a lot of philosophy behind it, and I believe that there's also, where is the intergenus species that are, you know, supposed to be there if it's the truth? I don't see them anywhere, you know? We don't see any frog birds or, you know, like kind of these intergenus species that are still kind of evolving today, you know. So I know and I believe that regardless of how the creation came about and whatever happened, about like how long it took, and I don't know, in the sense of, those are all questions for somebody else, but I know that God made man, and I know that when he made him in a very special way in order to receive his own life. And Father Sofroni even says, when God made man, this is a very bold thing to say, very profound, but very true. When God made man, he made nothing less than himself. We're a repetition of the uncreated God in a created form. I'm not uncreated. My soul was created for immortality, but I'm not immortal in the sense of, like, I'm not everlasting, you know? When God made man, he made nothing less than himself. And he made man in such a way as to be able to receive his life. And as much as he's willing to receive it, God is willing to give it. And this is what heaven is. It's this continuous growth into eternity and to God's own life forever. That part of man that's the hypostatic principle, it's called to continue in that growth process in eternity. And, this is no small thing. But this is what, sorry, I'll just continue for just a minute, but this is what gives our anthropology its great uniqueness. It's just like, at the fall, man was not irreparably corrupted and broken and destroyed. The image of God in man. That's not what the Orthodox Church teaches. The Orthodox Church says, yes, it was damaged. Yes, there was some problems. Yes, it is. It's deeply broken, but not totally gone. It's like it needs to be healed, you know? And so that's why for us, the fall is not as deeply kind of pessimistically catastrophic as it is for the West. You know, the West is just irreparable damage, you know? So God's just going to kind of save a few people as much as he can and then, you know, get out, you know, to, you know, to get to the promised land or whatever. It's not like that in Orthodoxy. Every person has an incredible value. Why? Because they were created to contain God. So when I look at you, I see the temple of the Holy Spirit. I see the one who was created to contain God. I see God.
And then to continue on with this idea of fellowship, we had a bishop in our area who once said that even if Adam did not sin, the pre-incarnate Christ would have become incarnate just the same.
Right. Said, well, you know, that's a big question.
Yeah.
dangerous, you know.
Right.
But the reality is, this is, I believe, and this is what St. Maximus says, as well as St. Nicholas Colossus, is that we live in a creation that was created for the incarnation. And then when God made man, he made him in such a way that when he became man, it would be the right, perfect fit. You know? that gives an incredible dignity and honor not only to the world, but to each of us. Again, we were created to contain God, not innately, but in potential. And that understanding that we look at, in that light, we see creation as innately sacramental, having this incredible sacramental potential just waiting to come out if we're ready and receptive and ultimately have the grace of God to open our spiritual eyes. You know, the heavens declare the glory of God and the firmament proclaim his handiworks. St. Paul says that we know God, the invisible God, by the things that are made, even his eternal majesty and his Godhead. We know the invisible God. We see the invisible God. Why? Through the things that were made, even his eternal majesty and his Godhead, his eternal power and Godhead. It's like, if we have that openness, like a childlike simplicity, and the purity of heart, we can see God. Where? Everywhere. Everywhere. If we start to question the first Adam, then it's not too long before we start questioning the second Adam. You know? Because there seems to be no need for him anymore. You know, so the whole thing starts to fall apart, and we have to realize what our anthropology really is, how we look at man, how we look at each other. I'll never forget the day that one of my professors, he's a patristics professor, teacher, he came in and he has this is his whole kind of life, you know, this is his work. And he came in and he sat down, and I'll never forget it, I can't remember exactly what he said, but he said something like, in the sight of God, man is so great, you know, created for such greatness. And he began to weep, and he wept for 5 minutes, and we all kind of stood there going, oh, what do we do now? You know, it was kind of difficult. It was a difficult moment, but really it kind of spoke to this reality. It's like, in the sight of God and in Christ, man is so, like, there's just unlimited potential and just infinite kind of honor and blessing that God has given to him in potential, you know. And this book, it even speaks to this man, the target of God, you know. Doesn't that say something? It's like God makes man his target. What is man that thou shouldst magnify him, he says in the book of Job, and that thou shouldest set thine heart upon him, and that thou, O God, shouldst visit him every morning and to try him at every moment. It's from the book of Job. What is man? Man, the target of God. It's like, it says so much, you know? So, did I answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
What was your question?
Yesterday when we were talking, walking the beach, one of the things you said to me that was really profound, which was related to the question you had about the Reformation and the plus, you had an interesting story about St. Nicholas of Japan. Mm-hmm. I was wondering if you could tell everybody else that story and how it applies, because I think it was very helpful for me.
You mean about his missionary work?
The missionary work and the type of work he was doing. The plus part of that.
Oh, right. Yeah, there's always that, you know, we can either be very cynical when it comes to people and culture, or we can affirm what's right. And, you know, I had one teacher who always said, you know, no matter who you're talking to, you always need to build on what is right. You don't point at what is wrong. We all have things that are wrong. It's like, if you knew me long enough, then you could point at me and say, you know what, Father, you got to do this, you got to do that. And that doesn't help. It doesn't help anybody. If we want to help people, you focus on what's right and you build on it. You want somebody to come to church, you focus on what is good and right in their way of thinking, and you build on it. And St. Nikolai of Japan is, he was named the greatest missionary of the 20th century by the Bible Society of the world, you know, like one of the world organizations. St. Nikolai of Japan was the missionary of, according to them, the 20th century. Why? Because when he started in 1867, there was one Orthodox Christian in Japan, and it was him. And by the time he was done, well, there might have been four, okay, but they were kind of coming and going. But by the time that he left, there was 30,000 plus. And there was 254 houses of prayer and churches. And one other bishop. And 50-something priests and deacons. And the entire scriptures, the gospel, the epistles, Old Testament, Menea, Triodion, Pentecostarian, everything was translated into Japanese by St. Nikolai of Japan. 5 hours every day for 40 years, except on feast days and Sundays. Right? St. Nikolai, he said that after dinner, him and his assistant would go into the room, and he said, and if there's an earthquake or something, he said, don't bother me. Just bring in the tea, and that's it. 5 hours every night, and he was the one that basically gave the Bible, the scriptures, to Japan. Because before that, they didn't really have they didn't have all of it, and it wasn't well translated. He actually created, just like any good missionary, they actually find the symbols that exist or create them themselves for the words and the terminology that needs to be explained. Like Cyril Methodius, right? They created the Slavonic language for the gospel. Those characters that they have in Slavonic, those were created for the gospel. You know? And same thing with St. Innocent. He had to kind of create diacritical marks and unique symbols for the Aleuts and for the work that he did in Alaska. And it was funny because providential that St. Nikolai met St. Innocent. They were both harbored in the same place in like 1861 or something like that. They were both wintering in the same place. They both got snowed in. And basically, St. Innocent was coming away from Alaska, finishing his amazing, amazing work in Alaska that he did for so many years. And St. Nikolai was on his way to Japan, and they both happened to be in the same place, isn't that funny, for 5 months. And St. Innocent imparted all of his wisdom and all of his techniques and all of his understanding to St. Nikolai of Japan. And St. Nikolai of Japan went to Japan and he did the same thing. And he said, those people in Japan were so ready for orthodoxy. He said that the culture couldn't be more ready. Why? Because he focused on what was good and positive. He didn't point out all of the stuff that was bad and wrong. Oh, this is that and blah, blah, blah. Don't do that. This is demon worship, et cetera, et cetera. He didn't do that. He looked for what was good and he affirmed it. And he built on it. And this is what St. Innocent of Alaska did as well. And it can be no different for us. It should be no different for us. We can't keep focusing on the negative and expect to get positive results. How would that work out? How does that work? That doesn't compute, does it? Negative plus positive doesn't equal positive. Like, you get either a zero or a negative. So in his work, one of his best friends was a Shinto priest. You know, that kind of shows you his perspective. But by focusing on the positive, by focusing on the liturgical life, he gave to Japan an inheritance that was priceless. And it was such an amazing work that he did. If he was probably like 200 years before, probably all of Japan right now would have been Christian, Orthodox Christian. Because what happened was right after he died, Russian Revolution, no money. All the money dried up, all the funding dried up. And then, of course, World War II, and the rest is history. So if it would have happened maybe 100 years before, no doubt in my mind, all of Japan would have been Orthodox Christian. I was just in Japan in July and venerated the relics of St. Nikolai of Japan. It was a wonderful experience. He's an incredible saint. Incredible saint. We have so many inspirational figures in our church. And the one thing that impressed me the very most about St. Nikolai was this. He didn't have anybody. He didn't have anybody to go to confession to. He didn't have a bishop that was on site, or even like within a, you know, he would write a letter to a bishop, maybe 6 months later it would come back. You know, he didn't have anything except the Lord, and he did it. He did it. And oftentimes in our own life, we feel alone. We feel by ourselves. We feel the weight of the cross on our back, and we feel like we want a Simon of Cyrene to help us to pick up our cross. St. Nikolai, he carried that cross. He was faithful to the end. He did it alone, with the Lord, by himself, and him and the Lord, and he did it. And I'm so deeply inspired by that, because who doesn't feel alone sometimes? Who doesn't feel like they just can't do it by themselves? It's like, here's a man that was in Japan, and he did what he did. It's just phenomenal, you know? So, anyways, it's again focusing on the positive and not kind of zeroing in on the negatives. You know, that was, I remember in seminary that one of the teachers says, you know, guys, we can either be like the bees or we can be like the flies. And here's the garden. He says, what are you going to go to? What are you going to choose to go to? You going to go be like the bee and go to the flowers, or are you going to be like the fly and go to the poop? You know? So it's up to us, you know, how we're going to do it. You know, it's in our, the ball is in our court. Sorry, YouTube.
Hello, Father. Thank you so much for your talk. My name is Christopher. During your talk, what stuck out to me a lot was your example of going outside of the inner monologue into conversation with Christ. As a student at university pursuing a business degree, I'm interested in finding out how, because we can get stuck into this thing, we got to make money in our careers, take care of a family, have all our needs met. How do we get outside of that inner monologue within our career and move it, make it into a conversation with Christ?
Well, I think there's just always a priority, a need for prioritization in our life, and that's ultimately God first and prayer first. You know, like I told the guys in seminary, I said, look, I said, because I had a hard semester, I said, I didn't cover most of my stuff that I want to cover, but if you don't remember anything I told you, this is the one thing I want you to know. If there's anything I can tell you that's going to make your life work and that your ministry will do well and that ultimately everything will be okay, prayer first. Never forget it, I told him. Because if prayer is right, everything else will be right. So that doesn't matter necessarily, like, I'm not needing to be praying all the day, you know what I mean? But this needs to be a priority in my life. Why? Because if I don't make it a priority and put it first, it'll be last. You know, if I don't make the time, I'll never have the time I need to make the time. So if you don't remember anything I said, prayer first. If I can do this, and if I can do this consistently, all will be well. All will be well. And ultimately, I'll be able to continue the being a little bit more open to the dialogue and a little less open to the monologue if I can always do this. That means church as well. You know, corporate and personal. That's included, it's both sides of the coin for this. Prayer first, you know? Ask for God's blessing and then live your life. I'll never forget there was an interesting story that Bishop Paul Tikhon told. He went to Mount Athos and he was asking one of his holy elders, monks or whatever, said, had this question. He said, what should I do? He got this very counterintuitive answer. He said, well, he said, sometimes we just have to do what we're going to do and ask God to bless it. So he said, well, what is God's will for it? Should I take this job or should I take that job? It's like, well, what would you like to do? Then you do it and you ask God to bless it. You know, because a lot of times God doesn't have a specific will in every single moment of our life. A lot of times he gives us a choice between what's good and what's better, you know? But he leaves the decision to us, and ultimately it's ours to ask God to bless what we do. He's not gonna micromanage us, you know? There's always those two wills that have integrity, God's will and my will. Neither of them are supplanted by the other. And both of them are equally respected. So, and by the way, before I forget, just so you know, remember that the monastery is open to the general public. If you have want to be on our mailing list, there's a sign-up sheet out there in the front. If you want to be on our newsletter, and to send we send you prayer cards if you want to fill them out twice a year, and stay in touch with us and so forth. If you'd like to, the mailing list is out there. As well as that fact that we have guest houses and so forth, you're always welcome. I know it seems a bit far away, but hey, I made it here, right? It's not too far, it's not that far. So just know that we pray for the church, and then ultimately, you know, this is kind of, it's our silent work in some ways, the liturgical life of the church, but just know that even by being present in liturgy, we're changed for the better. Change for the better. St. Maximus says, just by being present at the Eucharistic celebration, he says, we're ontologically altered for the better. Just by being present. And really that resurrectional power of Christ is deeply present in the liturgy. I can't tell you, day in and day out of having to either go to liturgy or serve liturgy or be in liturgy, sometimes I am kind of on the bottom of the spectrum and not very, I'd have a lot of work to do. And I not always have the energy to kind of be who I want to be or be as strong as I'd like to be. And sometimes I'm down there on the ground just kind of praying during the anaphora. And after the gifts are consecrated, I stand up and I feel better. I feel like alive again. I'm like, okay, I'm fine. Somehow I was changed in a way that was, I didn't have to necessarily receive communion to receive the benefit of what's going on there. And it's the same thing with the liturgy. Wherever it's celebrated throughout the world, it's benefiting us, it's helping us, it's strengthening us as a church. Why? Because we're one body. It doesn't matter if you're serving it in Japan or in South Canaan. It's like, it's the same liturgy for the same church. We're one body. It doesn't matter if I'm in Japan or not. I'm still part of you and you're still part of me. The more that I work for my own salvation, the more I help you. And vice versa, you know? We're in this together. And it's real. St. Paul says, you know, we are his flesh and his bones. His body is real body. And just as the Trinity is multi-hypostatic, in the sense that there's many persons but one being, right? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, multi-hypostatic. We're talking about that word hypostasis, person. It's multi-hypostatic or multi-person, one being. It's the same thing in the church. We're multi-hypostatic, but we have one being. There's only one being in this room right now, guys. Humanity, you know, man. Adam, the big A, Adam, right? It's us. There's one being in this room and we're multi-hypostatic and we're called to actualize and to image forth that life of the Trinity in this room. So that even though we're multi-hypostatic through our love that we have for each other, through our care, through our concern, we become one. Father, that they may be one, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one. And it tells us in the services, it says, unite us in the one will of thy commandments. So the more that you do the will of God, and the more that I do the will of God, and since as revealed by the gospel, the more closely we're united in a way that's eternal, unbreakable, and ultimately saves us. So it's this great mystery, but how to actualize the life of the Trinity in this room. So that being many persons, we have one will, we have one being, we have one Lord, we have one life, and we're one body. It's a great mystery, the mystery of the church. And ultimately this call to union, whether it's as us as a church or as a call as from us in our union with God, this is the plan of the ages. This is the reason for the creation. This is ultimately the blessed end for which everything was created for, the union of the created and the uncreated, so that God would fill all things. It's coming. It's coming. It's going to happen. We have to get ready. We have to be as ready as we possibly can. And when we're not ready, we have to say, God, I'm not ready. We still continue that honest conversation with God, that honest dialogue with God that offers rather not our perfection, but our poverty. And in that moment of truth, the Spirit of truth can still abide in us. And we still can be made one as Father and Son and Holy Spirit are one. Why? Because in that moment that we speak the truth abides in us. And dwells in us forever. Like it says, you know, come and abide in us and cleanse us from every impurity and save our souls, O good one. This is the mystery of what salvation is. God wills our salvation. It's like, I don't know how the doctrine of double predestination ever happened. It's a doctrine that some people are created for hell. I don't know how that happened. Why? Because in the scriptures it says very clearly that, what does it say? I'm kind of tired. God wills the salvation of all men. Yeah, it's not the will that any should perish, but all that should ever rest. But God wills the salvation of all men. It's God's will for us to be saved. How can you create people for hell if it's God's will for us to be saved? It doesn't make any sense at all. And God's foreknowledge, in no way, shape, or form, lessens our ability to choose. There's no kind of fatalism or kind of, you know, predestination and orthodoxy, that paradox is maintained. We're still free. You know? Like the saying goes, love God and do as you please. If we really put the love of God first in our life, everything else will be okay. We'll do the right thing. Why? Because we want to love God. If you say, love God and love your neighbor, you'll do well. If you really put those first in your life, everything else will be fine. Everything else will kind of fall into place as it should. We don't have to worry about a lot in that regard. But ultimately, we just have to continue to follow Christ.
Okay, we'll take our last question from Ryan. Multiple times in the last week, I've had atheists and Protestants start conversations with me about moral progress as a cultural value. Mm-hmm. And something about the conversation makes the cards stacked against me from the get-go. I was wondering what would be a good Orthodox approach to maybe reframing that conversation?
The conversation of avoiding it?
Moral progress. And then
moral progress.
It's typically followed up by standard cultural values of place of women in society and those sorts of things.
Yeah. That's a tough one. This is the last question. Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, this is the easiest way that you can couch it. That whole idea of moral relativism is it basically kind of falls apart in the ethical perspective of this idea of what is it that leads me to communion with the only true God. You know, so number one, it's like it's relational first and foremost. We're not moralists in the church, you know. I'm not good for goodness sake, even though I'd like to be good for goodness sake. It's not a strong enough pull anymore. You know what I mean? So the question is, does this lead me to union with the creator of life? Or does this lead me towards the gates of hell and death? It's an existential question. Certain activities will lead me towards death. And so therefore, they are morally wrong because they don't lead to life. Now, if I can't recognize that because I'm so dull and I'm so kind of dumbed down, that's fine. All I have to do is witness to that fact. I don't have to convince anybody anything. I just make my stand on basically the truth. There are certain activities, sex outside of marriage, it will lead me towards the gates of death. I'm sorry. It does not lead me to communion with the creator of life. Why? Because he said, don't do that. I don't know why it's like that, but it is like that. And a lot of times in theological parlance, it's not a why, it's an is. God is three persons, one being. I don't know why. I can't give you the why. It's like, we just don't even ask that. Like, you know, Jesus Christ is God and man. Why? Like, I don't know why. It just is. It's the same thing with this. Ethically speaking, it's like, why does this lead towards death? I don't know why. It just is. This is the way it is. And so ultimately that objectiveness of the reality of this ethical consideration of communion with God, it's the first and foremost in my mind when these questions come up. What leads me towards life or God, who is the source of life, and what leads me towards death or that which is like empty of God and devoid of God's grace? What increases grace? What decreases grace? This is really my only consideration in this question. And ultimately it's a relational one because all of those things are like the do's and don'ts, you know. It's all revealed in the light of God's person. There's a certain kind of parameter I need to abide in order to be with that person, just like there's a certain kind of parameter I need to abide in to be with you guys, you know. If I came in here and I was wearing a turban and I said, you know, namaste or something like that, and, you know, had a big peace sign on, it's like, I'm not going to be able to really abide in communion with kind of the standard Orthodox tradition, you know. It's kind of like, you know, I'm off base, and it's the same way with God. It's like there's certain kind of parameters that in order to have a relationship with God, I need to try to maintain. And ultimately, it really leads me to kind of the fulfillment of my own person. It's not something that's antithetical to my own personhood. It leads me to the fulfillment of that personhood. So I'm not going against myself in any true or eternal way. I may be going against myself in the false and egotistical and passionate way, but that's okay. You know what I mean? I don't necessarily have to tell everybody about that when I'm explaining that answer to them, but ultimately I always say, what is it that leads me to communion with my Creator? And ultimately, the Creator is the one who reveals himself. I can't know God unless he reveals himself to me. So am I open to that revelation? Since I'm created and I know God is uncreated, I need to be open to that revelation from that eternal God. If I'm not open, it's like, and I'm not willing to respond, faith really isn't going to be generated in my heart. Because ultimately what faith is a response. God does something, and then he waits for me and see if I do something. It's that sense of responding to him. If I don't respond, then there's no faith that's really generated. It's almost like kind of like the magnetism or something that happens in that interaction. You know, faith is generated. The textbook definition of faith is the light that comes from grace. The light that comes from grace. So if I say I've lost grace, it means that I've lost God. Or actually, if I say I've lost my faith, it means I've lost grace. Oh, I don't believe in God anymore. Well, you've lost grace. You've lost the grace of God, which actually is inherent in all creation. And you've driven it away, you know? So this is a really difficult question for our modern age. But I think, though, that, you know, there's a saying, it says, everyone's fighting a hard battle, so be kind. And I'd rather see a sermon than hear one anyway, any day. They'll know you by the love that you have for each other. People don't care how much we know until they know how much we care. Love those people anyways. Be kind to them anyways. Show them Christ. And that will be the opportunity to evangelize them. You know, it won't be in our words and about right and wrong and this and that. It's going to be like, did they see Christ in me? And if they did, then they're like, oh, there's another way. There's another life, and it's eternal. And like, I can see it sometimes in the church. I can see it sometimes in the priests and in the bishops and in the congregation. And in, I don't see it all the time, but it's like, I need it as well. You know what I mean? Like, I need to be reminded of that other life, of that other way that ultimately is something that's so far above. Like Christ says, you are from beneath, I'm from above. You are of this world, I'm not of this world. It's like, but in that person of Christ, everything is explained. Everything is explained. So any of the moralistic kind of ethical considerations, it's in Christ's person, encountering that person and having a relationship with that person that's responsive. That's how I get my answers, but can't necessarily give that to somebody. I can show them, I can try to be it. I might be very poor, but that's the only real way that it's gonna, it can, you know, kind of offer them something, you know. They always have a saying, they say, once you're done serving all liturgy at your own heart, you go to your neighbors and you serve there. So go serve liturgy for them.